Welcome to the ESI Small Experiments podcast, where we have conversations with University of Groningen instructors to inquire about what they have been testing, tweaking, or trying out in their teaching and learning activities, and what they observed and learned about themselves and their students in the process. Our guest for episode 8 is Marijke Leliveld, assistant professor at the marketing department of the Faculty of Economics and Business. Marijke studies consumer decision-making, and particularly moral decision-making, like donations to charity or buying products which benefit charities as well. And she teaches courses in research methodology, ethics in international business, and marketing communication. Our conversation took place on March 16, 2021, and has been edited for length. In this episode, Marijke shares her experiences using the web-based platform Gathertown, currently a university-wide pilot initiated by members of the Young Academy Groningen, or YAG, of which she has volunteered to be the faculty coordinator for FEB. While not a replacement for physically being together, Gathertown mimics natural movement and conversation in an online setting. She has found many creative uses for the tool to enhance her teaching, grading, professional development, and various team activities. Well, welcome to the podcast, Marijke. This is the first episode we've done in Gathertown, so this is going to be really fun. And
I hope so. Yeah.
Thank you for inviting me into your virtual classroom.
No worries. You're welcome.
Nice. So Gathertown has been a pilot project at the university. Could you explain sort of how you got involved with that and what your role is within the project?
Yeah, so the background basically is that Martijn Wieling, also from the Young Academy, already used it for his department and his group of students and also for teaching. And then he wanted to kind of see whether he was actually very excited and very enthusiastic. And he also shared his enthusiasm that we had our annual day of the Young Academy also in Gathertown. So everybody kind of also got excited. And then he even enthused the university boards, and they were willing to put some money in so we could do a proper pilot of like the pros and the cons of this platform in teaching, but also for departments to get a better coherent feeling instead of being in your on your own. He got money for that, and it's really well arranged. So ESI is also involved, trying to kind of support with the student assistant that we could hire. And I'm the FEB coordinator of this pilot, basically. So just for my faculty, I'm coordinating which courses are involved and which events and which departments. Yeah. And I'm also a big fan. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I have to admit, the first time I saw Gathertown, I was not really a fan. I mean, I thought it was nice, but I thought, how would we actually use this in our teaching? Because I was picturing it for maybe like lectures or things more traditionally. And then I thought it maybe wasn't the best platform for that. But now that I've been talking with people like you and Marijke van Vught and others who are using it in really creative and different ways, I'm really starting to become a fan myself. Can you explain a little bit more about how you're using it in your courses and what you see the benefits being over a traditional video conferencing platform?
Yeah, so what we currently have is the system that basically everybody is in one big group. So if you're with a group of 50 people, you cannot just kind of sit next to each other and just talk to one-on-one person, right? Like what you normally have, if you have a big meeting, you just sit next to each other. Sometimes you chat a bit, and in a break, you kind of talk to smaller groups. And that's the same also with teaching. So we're all there, and of course there can be breakout groups, but that has to be organized, and then people are stuck in that group and they cannot contact you as a teacher if you're not in that group, so it's all very artificial. And for me, the Gathertown platform kind of actually enables it that you can have this more informal real life way of talking to each other. So the moment that we are close to each other, it automatically connects the cameras and the audio, so you can just chat with the person you see walking around. You can just approach that person, say, "Hey, that's a long time ago, and how are you doing?" And also there's with the breakout groups, for example, you can just say to the students, okay, you and you go to room one and you go to room two and just do this kind of breakout assignment in class. And I can, as a teacher, walk, basically go to all those rooms and just say, hey, how are you doing? Are there any questions? Students can find me if they have a question. So it is kind of like normal life. So that's basically, I think, the best thing of Gather is that it mimics the real life, that you're not in a whole group and that everything you say that everybody has to hear, you can mimic that. Yeah, very good. I love it.
Yeah. Yeah. Maybe we could take a step backwards, actually, and kind of all maybe decrease our webcam size so we can show people what it looks like, because maybe there are people who've never used it and they aren't quite sure what we're talking about.
Yeah, sure. So I think it would be best, I mean, if you just kind of walk around, because it's kind of, this is just a new environment for you, and I will just follow you, because it's also one of the option. It is in real life, you should not do this because it's kind of stalking, but here you can do this. let's see, I will follow you. And now the moment that you start walking, I will follow you and I can just explain where we are and how it works. So just move around.
Fantastic. All right. So this classroom, in essence, is set up to look sort of like some of the university buildings. Is that correct?
Yeah. So this particular one has been kind of created with this idea that you have a general space where you can work, and there are several rooms, but the entrance basically are these two stairs from the academy building, right? So that's kind of the mimicky system. Yeah. I will follow you again. Yeah. Yeah. And this location where we are now is kind of the main room where you can just hang around and we can meet up people. But the more you kind of walk around, you see these rooms popping up with the numbers like 2, 3, and 4. And those are the breakout rooms. And the thing is that if you enter one of those breakout rooms, you cannot automatically, you're connected to people who are also in that room and people on the hallway. Look, there we kind of transferred. You cannot hear people on the hallway anymore. So you're in a private space, as they call it.
Right now you're following me. And so for people who haven't used it, you have to be within a certain proximity of each other's digital character in order to be able to access their webcam and microphone and have a conversation.
And in the private spaces, they kind of, it's made as such that, like, you don't, it doesn't matter how far away you are from each other in this room. You can still hear each other, but in the hallway, it's the natural thing. Like, you have to be close enough to talk to each other. It's the same like being in the office, and you're not screaming to the other person like at the end of the hallway. You only talk to each other when you're close enough, and that's what it's mimicking. But this private space it's very easy. You just go in, and automatically, you are connected to those who are also in that room.
Okay, so this room 2 that we're in right now, if you weren't standing next to me, we would automatically be able to connect because we're in room 2 together.
Yeah.
Got it. And then I don't know where you've placed them, but are there also spotlights where the teacher can speak to everyone in the whole
If you go to the classroom? Right and then to this microphone below. Yes, there, maybe one step, maybe you already see it popping up in your screen. Maybe a little bit to the left, to the right. Sorry, I'm very bad in my, So I got to notice that I was in the spotlight position. It's around there.
Yeah.
Very good.
I think did as well at one point.
And from that position, basically, you can talk to everybody in all rooms. So everybody in room 1 to 9 we have, they can actually hear you. So for example, it's easy to way to say like, hey, you've got 5 minutes to finish up this in-class assignment, and then we meet up again in this main room, which is very helpful if you kind of want to address, make a comment to everybody instead that you have to go to each room, of course, separately.
Yeah, and that's how it is in breakout groups, say in Collaborate, is you have to go into each room separately to make announcements or use the chat. Yeah, so that's nice. So, but you have to be standing on the spotlight in order to talk to people.
Yeah, and it's really one way direction, right? So they can hear me, but it's not that I can hear everybody. So for the lecture of the education part itself, or the main lecture room, we had this this location here below, if you follow me. So those are the chairs here. And that's also, again, a private space. So here it's just a general, and the farther away I go from you, we kind of automatically kind of lose each other. We can even try it a little bit so I can walk away.
Yes, so now I've lost. Yes, I lost you and you came back. Yeah.
So this is how it works. But it doesn't work like that if you go to the seats below. So if you follow me, otherwise you kind of lose me. There it goes. Look, this it is. And you can just sit. There you are. And this is, again, a private space. So if you sit on one of those chairs, you can talk to each other. So this is where I had my lecture, and I was talking to people, to my students, and I was sharing my screen, because that's also still an option in Gather. So that's it's very convenient, basically, to have this private spaces where the distance doesn't matter. It's just if you are there, you can hear each other. And the rest of the floor basically is this normal real life mimicking the distance aspect.
Yeah, nice. Maybe I'll just open. So in the bottom toolbar, there's a mini map just to give people an idea. So right now it shows where my icon is sitting. But then for people who are watching, you can see room 1, 2, 3 and so on around to room 9. And then, the sort of corridor spaces where people would be walking to get to places. And you just use your arrow keys to move yourself around in the space. And it looks kind of like an old school video game, which is kind of fun. Yeah.
Yeah. And you can even, it's silly. It's not kind of, it doesn't help you kind of teach better, but it's a fun aspect. You can also change your avatar. So I'm not sure whether the minimap is still on, but if you kind of remove that, you can change the avatar. You see my avatar now changing. So my little mini figure.
Yes.
There's even with wheelchairs, and there's with scarves, and there's with, all kind of things. So it's, they try to do different. You can have a beard. You can be all types of different scholar. You can even be a snowman. So that's, very important. It makes it even more fun. Like, okay, so what character is this person choosing?
Nice. So you have the ability to go into small groups, like a natural conversation where if you stand together, you can talk, but also as the teacher to broadcast your announcements to everyone, which is really nice. And like you said, people can, if you're not on the announcement spot, but you're in a room yourself or somewhere in the main area, they can come out of their rooms and find you in order to ask questions and things similar to a real classroom, which is really nice. Yeah. So can you maybe talk about how you've used this in some different courses? Like I said, I don't see it being a great tool for lecturing, although someone could prove me wrong on that. But you had mentioned that you've been using it more for tutorials or smaller group work that aren't the large lecture component of your course. Yeah.
No, I think large lectures, that doesn't really kind of add to it. It's really kind of for smaller groups or for groups where you can have this, where you have the idea of breakout groups, etc. With larger lectures, most often you don't do that. But for tutorial groups, it's very convenient because it's a way to also during breaks, for example, don't have this weird situation that like, okay, we're going to have a 10-minute break and basically everybody's still there or maybe kind of shuts down the camera. And because again, you cannot talk to each other in small groups, right? The moment you say something, the entire group of 40 or 50 people will hear. And here you can just walk around. So you can just kind of approach a person and say like, hey, how are you doing? And then like have a normal kind of break time. So I think that also helps for students to feel that they are connected, right? Not just one person in a larger group, but that they can really kind of walk around, move around. So for me, that was a big plus. And it feels also as if you are more connected because you see each other sitting, which of course, I mean, you know, it's virtual, etc. But I think it really works like that in the mind. And if you see people walking around or getting to class or in the room, it feels really as if you're kind of much more connected than in this kind of in the, for example, via Blackboard system. Yeah. So I use it for that, and especially with breakout groups and smaller assignments, it's very convenient. So that's how I use it in my class. I also know that some people use it for students that they basically can go there whenever they want, for example, also to collaborate on projects, right? So they can, you don't necessarily have to use it only for a 2-hour tutorial, but you can just open it up and students can meet each other there and work on assignments. So there are several ways to kind of use the system, and it's really up for you as a teacher. I didn't do that in my course only also because I only had 2 sessions with my group of students, and I just wanted to kind of try out, and it was in the very early stages of the pilot, and I thought, okay, I just do it. But it's the collaboration and it's the ease of working together that's really convenient. Yeah.
Yeah, and what have your students said about it? And here's the first big question. Do they actually turn on their webcams in this environment?
Yes, they do. Although, of course, it does. I mean, it does require quite some kind of Wi-Fi connection, etc. So I'm actually fine if they don't necessarily turn it on, maybe in this larger group where we are now. But especially in the smaller groups, there's nobody who doesn't do it. So everybody kind of turns on their webcam and start talking to each other. So I think that also kind of benefits this feeling of like working together. And because then I kind of walk around, I also see their faces at least once. But of course, I mean, it does require some Wi-Fi connection that you kind of see all the videos and share yours. So I can also understand that some students don't always do that. Yeah.
Yeah. But overall, the feedback from students has been that they enjoy it.
Yeah. So, I mean, I haven't seen the official kind of survey yet. I just sent it out. Actually, the survey was just finished. So I sent it out to my students, particularly on this aspect. But what I heard from the students is that they just like, it's just different. It's a bit more fun. It's a bit more like the real world. And I think, yeah, especially in this time where everything is so kind of boring and all the same, that just something that is different kind of makes life nicer. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. And that's certainly the research that our ESI Educational Innovation Research Team has been doing. It really indicates that both teachers and students are really missing connection with each other, and that our mental health is even starting to suffer, because as human beings, we're hardwired for connection with other human beings. So this has been a really hard year. And so this is a nice way of helping people feel a bit more connected, even though we still aren't ready yet to be in the physical spaces together.
No, and for example, so this is the kind of an educational setup, but we also kind of built our kind of rebuild our department hall basically in Gather, in another space, and there I also see it's just a lot of fun. It's easy to connect to people who are just in their offices and just kind of drop by for a minute. I'm not the person who kind of makes an official appointment to somebody who just started at their department, because we have got like so many colleagues. But then you also don't see them on the hallway. But now with this virtual group, I saw kind of her walking like through the hallway, and I was like, hey, maybe she's lost or doesn't know how it works. So I just pop out of my office like, hey, how are you doing? And then we at least e-meet, right? So that's better than nothing. And there's also some colleagues who do fun stuff. So there was this colleague popping by and saying, hey, do you want some chocolate? Because you can have this fake chocolate gift thing. And he kind of puts something on my virtual desk. There's another colleague who put a nice small gift in my office. And you could even interact with that. So you can press then an X, and then that thing pops up. And he or she, I still don't know who it was, like, hey, I wish you a good day with a lot of fun things. Okay, cool. And there's even one colleague who put a jukebox in, and now every time if you pass it in the hallway, you hear Rick Astley singing. So that's it's just fun. Yeah, it's a lot of fun.
And the benefit of the digital version of chocolates is that they don't contribute to your corona kilos.
That's for sure. On the other hand, I have been craving about chocolate the entire afternoon ever since I got it. But it was a nice jest. Yeah.
Yeah. Nice.
Yeah.
And you suggested So a number of different ways to use it aside from just your tutorials, which is already a great idea. But I saw on Twitter that you'd created your own little environment by fireplace for marking with your assistants. And we had spoken previously about the idea of maybe even having like a conference or congress or something. Could you talk more about those things as well?
Well, I think especially for this smaller scale kind of symposia or conferences, this is an ideal setting. So you could have parallel sessions like you would normally have. You could have this kind of space where people just walk around and meet up. And I think that's awesome, because that's exactly what you're missing, right? This kind of small talk. And that's exactly what this platform really mimics very well. That it's, I had it with my own kind of jag, the heidags, or annual kind of day with the whole group. I mean, I saw some people I hadn't seen for quite some time, and I didn't speak to, and I just saw them walking around, and I just kind of, well, with my arrows walked to them, and like, hey, how are you doing? It's been, how you feel? And you're just chatting like you normally would, but without all the others, right? I mean, they can also get to us and just join the conversation. But it's not that we have to chit chat in front of the whole audience. So I think for these kind of small scale conferences, this is a great platform actually to use. And instead of that, people have to travel for a one day symposia from like whatever the world and to see these talks and to discuss. This is a very easy way actually to mimic that. And of course, seeing each other in real life, it does add to it. But I think a system like that, especially for this more smaller scale and maybe one day kind of events, perfect. Yeah.
Yeah, nice. And then the marking, could you talk about that as well? How did that end up working out?
Yeah, so normally I'm marking with my TAs. They help me with marking the exams. And normally they sit in my office and they all kind of open up the laptops and we discuss like how to grade a certain question and like, okay, if they say this, is that sufficient or not for a point? And so I always kind of steer this discussion because I want, of course, that the graders kind of do the same thing, right? They have the same marking procedure. And now that wasn't possible. So I just wanted to have them kind of, again, close by. And instead of like doing it via Google Hangouts or whatever, I just thought, okay, it just make life a bit more fun to kind of sit at the fireplace in this office and they just kind of walk around. And I mean, it doesn't change in the end. We just need a platform to talk to each other, but it just feels a little bit more fun. And that's also what they said. But I also use it, for example, for thesis defenses, where I'm together with the co-supervisor and the students, and they present their work and we ask some questions. And normally they do that here in one of those rooms, and then we send them out on the hallway, we discuss their grade and we kind of fill in the form and then we ask them back. And if you do that via Hangouts or maybe even via Nestor, you really have to send them an email like, okay, we're ready. So now you can join again and you have to wait. And in my kind of own private, this is a living room, there were several carpets, so several private spaces. So I could just say to that student, like, if you go to the blue carpet, I will pick you up the moment that we're ready. And you know that they can't hear you. So they can't kind of eardrop or whatever, because that's how it's designed. And I could just pick them up and return to the gray carpet and then discuss the final grade. So it's not always kind of really adding to it, but it's just fun. I think it's just a fun factor. It's moving around, seeing people walking, it's that makes it just more fun.
But I think what you just said, so in the example with the like calling the student back and sending them away, that reduces anxiety if all they have to do is move their arrow key and then you come over and call them back in, rather than they're waiting by an email hoping they check it in time and get the right link and go to the right place. So that's actually a really nice solution for it, I think. Yeah, that's a great idea.
Yeah, and they can already check before, right? So I mean, this space is open. So basically, because you know the password, you can kind of enter this room the moment that you want, just to check whether things work, etc. Because it's not a it's not a planned meeting with a kind of a set date or time when it starts and when it ends. I think that's also one of the benefits for students who are like, okay, does it work and how does it work? They can just kind of already walk around, move around. They can even meet up with other students to kind of do their tour on with the two of them and see how it works. So that's if they're really going to have their lecture then, they know how it works and they have seen it. So I think that's also one of the risky feeling of like, oh my God, does it work? And how does it work? You can also reduce that. Yeah.
Yeah. That's really important because we don't want to contribute to more anxiety for people right now. We're all struggling with enough things. Go ahead.
Can I say, so what I also hear from students, I mean, it's very intuitive to use, right? So, I mean, if I just introduce, go here, put in the passwords and just, you got your avatar and you can move around with your arrow keys. Basically, then none of my students had extra questions. They automatically found the fact that you can also chat to people. You can chat to people nearby. You can chat to everybody. You can set a chat to one of those participants in the group. They find where they can kind of change their avatar. It's a very kind of intuitive program. So it's you don't have to kind of be a computer rock star to get this. And especially students, I mean, they are way better than us oldies. But nobody not understands. It's very easy. Yeah.
Yeah, so not a lot of technical support required, which is always a benefit. Because that is something people bring up a lot, is that we don't want to be overwhelming our students or ourselves with too many different tools.
Yeah.
But this one is, like you said, quite easy to enter. You don't need a separate login and password. No. I mean, you can password protect the rooms. And then once you're there, it's very easy to just use your arrows and move around, as you said. So nice. So as I said, I had been talking to Marijke van Vught from FSE, and she's the coordinator of this project in that faculty. And she was doing some really neat things with this for things such as poster sessions. So that students could be with their poster. So you can actually incorporate different documents or different things into the environment as well. And then people could go to the different poster sessions to actually be part of their presentation. I don't know if you meet as a team with the pilot contacts, but have you heard of any other really neat ways of using it that have inspired you?
No, so I see things at least like you, it's popping up and we talk about it. So I need the poster session and basically the sharing of documents, work together on a document is really convenient. So for example, you can put a link in each of those nine rooms if you want to have students to work on separate assignments. But you can put for each room a separate Google Doc link, for example, where you kind of prepare, this is the question you have to answer, and they all open it up because they enter the room. You can press this X to interact, that's how you call it, with a document. So you automatically open that, and then everybody is in the same document. They can work together, they see each other typing, so that also adds to this feeling of like we're in the same group. And I think that's really beneficial. That's really helpful. Yeah.
Yeah. Nice. And there's even, I've seen different environments where, you can embed videos or different things like that to interact with. Yeah. So,
So you can have a link to, for example, YouTube movie, like YouTube, like Rick Astley, right? I mean, that's one of the options, or something more kind of educational. But that's definitely a possibility. Yeah. So that's really cool. Yeah. And I think a poster session is ideal, right? So you can, again, kind of interact with that document being the poster, and you can open it up, you can read it, you can have the person talk to you and kind of read through you like what you normally have in a poster session. So these are all great ways to work together. Yeah.
Yeah. Excellent. Yeah, so mostly small group types of things would work best in this environment.
Yeah, it really depends on what you do, right? If you have like a larger group, but you have an idea of like how to kind of make smaller groups and let them kind of walk around, then I think it also works for bigger groups. So far, I've been using it like up to 30 or with your high log 50 and maybe 75. I mean, again, it really depends on what you want. If you just use it for lecturing, I would not kind of recommend it because then it doesn't have any kind of added value. But especially kind of the interacting, kind of breaking out in different type of groups, working together on Google Sheets or Google Docs in subgroups and then presenting people with the outcome of it. That's just ideal. And especially the breaks, right? So the break time where normally it's kind of weird, you just sit and wait until you kind of start again. And now you can actually kind of, well, with your cup of coffee, walk around and go to somebody you want to talk to or just kind of hang around. Yeah.
Yeah. And for people who don't want to interact, maybe they're using it for a bathroom break or grabbing another coffee. They can make themselves unavailable to chat with.
Yes.
Right?
Yeah. And so it's not that you have to talk or whatever. You can, even if you are in a talk with somebody you don't like, you can even say that you want to go to the bathroom and just kind of like a normal life, right? you can just run away. Yeah. It's all possible.
So a lot more, natural conversation. Like,
yes.
I think that's something we're all missing. And obviously it's not a replacement for face-to-face contact because we really, I think, have realized during this time we miss that so much.
Yeah.
But for the time being and for certain purposes, it can certainly sort of bridge the gap or offer an alternative in the meantime.
Because what I see in the Nestor environment or in Google Hangouts, most of the meetings you have are really kind of functional, right? So they you plan them in because you want to discuss something or have this tutorial. So you therefore are kind of trying to tick off the boxes that you want to do in the tutorial. But what you miss is this kind of spontaneous talk during breaks or before the session starts or just kind of running to a new colleague on the hallway, right? And if you don't work with that new colleague for your research or teaching, I mean, normally it's not that you don't see them because you're going to lunch or you see them at the printer. And that's what Gathertown can capture. So that's why it's really good for the group cohesion to feel part of a group rather than working in your office or in your kind of home office just on your own.
Yeah. I love the American author Simon Sinek, and he had this video where he was talking about how trust is built in the moments between the meetings, not in the meetings themselves. And now, like if we do a Google Meet or a Collaborate, we join instantly at the time it's supposed to begin, and there is no chit chat or running into each other or having the opportunity to walk over to someone you see. And so there isn't a lot of trust building being done because our meetings are very functional and there's not a lot of conversation. So this is a really nice way of, like you said, mimicking more of what we can do in our real life.
Yeah. So for me, that's really the added value of it. And again, you can do so many things in it and you can make it nicer, put even more plants in your office or jukeboxes and whatever. So you can go quite wild. And we have a great bunch of student assistants who are part of this pilot who are building this. So I didn't build it myself. I should give Michiel van Eldik all the kind of credits to this. This is just awesome. I'm very happy that we could do this pilot, and I'm looking forward to seeing the results of how students and also teachers in the end evaluated it. And but for now, I only hear positive stories. Yeah.
Nice. And then how long until the pilot concludes and we know if it will be made available more widely?
I think it's about like the end of block 2.2. That's kind of the time that we are, I think, setting, like gathering all the data of the surveys and getting all the inputs, and then kind of writing a final report and then see how it's kind of can be used in the future. And of course, it also depends on the future, whether we're going to kind of the hybrid teaching or tutorials still like and maybe on campus, but I'm not sure whether that would kind of is feasible for all the courses we have and all the teaching we have. So this might still be a very good platform to kind of keep in mind, especially for hybrid teaching. I think this is a nice way to do it. Yeah,
nice. And then, so anyone can go just to the Gathertown site and make their own room if it's for less than 25 people, is that correct?
Yeah. So we have a university account, so basically the idea is that if you have an educational account, so rug.nl, for example, you can just kind of sign up and there's you don't have to do anything. But indeed, if you have more than 25 people in your room, then you have to start paying. And part of the pilot is also kind of that you're able to actually have, for example, tutorial 50 or 30 people in a room at once. But that's where we as coordinators step in, that we at least make sure that like we know what rooms are built, what spaces are built, and at what time frame we can expect people to come in, so that not at one time on Monday from 11 to 1 there's like 800 people at the same time on our license. So that's those are the things that needs to be coordinated.
Of like scheduling for normal physical classrooms, now you're coordinating the scheduling for these rooms as well. Okay. Yeah. Good to know.
Yeah. So it's not entirely kind of for free, but for me it really pays off. This is so this is especially also the department, right, that we now have rebuilt. For me that's just fun. I mean, I speak to people that I normally would not have made a formal appointment in their calendar or
Are there any downsides to it that you've noticed or cons?
Well, the one kind of downer side is that it doesn't automatically track who's talking, at least so far that it's not doing. Maybe they're also working on that, but so far that's not the case. So if you have many people in your class and sometimes people are talking and kind of are in discussion, you don't necessarily, it doesn't automatically go to the video of that person talking. So that's a downside. And indeed, what I sometimes hear from students, especially students, because they don't, for example, they share their Wi-Fi with like all the other people in their house, for example, is that it asks quite a lot of what is bandwidth of the internet. So that's, for some people, it can be a problem. So far, I didn't have any issues with it also at my own place, but that might be an issue. So I wonder, I'm really looking forward to hearing from the students and seeing the survey results, whether it's incidental or whether it's kind of a bigger thing. I just don't know.
Yeah, that's a good thing to investigate. The other thing I've heard is like a lot of people like to record their sessions and there's no internal recording function within. I mean, right now I'm recording our session, but I have special software on my own computer that I was able to make that work. But it's not a baked in feature of Gathertown.
No, indeed. Yeah. So there's no recording.
So like you said, lectures and things like that, they'd be better off in Collaborate or Meet or something.
Yeah, because I mean, it's this is about interacting, and with large lectures, normally, at least what I do in my larger course with like 400 or 600 students, is that I mainly do pre-recorded lectures so they can see themselves at their time that they are kind of are liking to see it, so to watch it. And then I have like Q&A sessions, right? So in the Q&A sessions, that could be potentially here. On the other hand, the problem is that if all my 600 students come in, that's kind of a problem. Most often they don't, but that's a bit rough on the edges. So that makes it a bit more complicated, like how to organize that. But yeah, for lectures, kind of one way kind of direction, kind of just providing information, then this doesn't add to it. No, it's really about the interaction. It's about the breaks. It's about moving around rather than feeling that you're like just stuck in your screen and you're there with the entire group or you're not. There's no in between. And I think that's just weird. Yeah.
Yeah, it's certainly been an adjustment.
Yes.
For us all. This is really nice. And like I said, our research is showing that all of our university students and instructors really want more conversation and informal moments. So this is a really easy way to incorporate some of that while we're still in the waiting period before we can return to physical classrooms. So,
well, yeah, I think, I mean, the more people who are here, the funnier it is to see them walking around like little shh. So that's something I couldn't kind of show you because then we should have invited many more people. But I think that's every time it happens, then I say, okay, now we're here. Now we go to the breakout rooms. I just enjoying seeing my students running around and going to the correct room. And yeah, it's maybe indicative of how kind of not exciting our lives is nowadays. But on the other hand, I mean, it gives me a lot of joy. So yeah. It's good.
And
it's good.
It's to have those small moments of joy that we have to look for now, for sure.
Indeed.
Educational Support and Innovation, or ESI, is the central instructional support team for all educators at the University of Groningen. To find out more about the services and resources we have made available during this interesting time in the world and in academic education, please visit edusupport.ruch.nl.